Please join me in welcoming Administrator Walker.
Thank you. It is great to be here. I always love to come and talk to y'all and meet with y'all. And as a former state person, and I do consider y'all to be kind of far north, but it's always great to come up and meet with you. So I think I've spoken, maybe not to this conference before, but I know I've spoken in Kentucky on several occasions, and I think I always start off by saying that there's a lot going on at EPA. It is a really active time. At the very outset of this administration, we were given three key directions to focus on our core environmental mission, cleaner air, cleaner land, and cleaner water, and to do it. And the next two directives were really about how we do it, and they were about doing it in collaboration with states and with the regulated community and other partners, and doing it, as you certainly heard from Matt Leopold earlier, doing it kind of faithful to our statutory authority and within the rule of law so that we can create certainty for the regulated community and certainty for states as we work as partners. So that really have been our marching orders, and we have really been working over the last 2 years to put those into practice in our day-to-day work, in our regulatory decisions, and in the day-to-day way we interact with states and with the regulated community when we're directly carrying out our work. So I'll talk a little bit about maybe our priorities for the next year, and I hope as I do that what you hear is those three themes coming through and everything that we're gonna be focused on. So in terms of priorities, there are kind of two sets of priorities I think of that we have for the next year. And some of that, and it's really just an extension of what we've been doing for the last two. So some of that is really this regulatory reform agenda that Matt talked about. And that really, when I think about regulatory reform and our work there, I think about addressing the areas of overreach that we experienced in the last administration, which Matt talked about WOTUS, and we've talked about WOTUS and CPP, and we'll do that again later on this panel. It's also in our day-to-day work as we implement programs, as we look at our processes where we're reviewing state actions and it's taken a really long time and we're a delay in the process, or when we're directly implementing programs and we're enforcing or we're issuing permits, we need to do that in a timely manner so we provide an effective and streamlined process. So that's a key part of our focus operationally, and as well as from a policy standpoint. And then secondly, that core environmental mission piece, there are some really key environmental challenges that we continue to face, and we are focused on putting in place tools to address them. So some of those are legacy issues like water infrastructure that we've talked about and we'll talk about again, where we just need tools and we need to keep focus on that. And some of them are emerging issues like PFAS. So when I think about our key program priorities, on the air side, we're really focused on state implementation plans and our work in that piece, which is reviewing and approving those in a timely manner so that our work doesn't delay good work on the part of states. We have historically had significant backlogs in our air SIPs, and we're looking to address those backlogs and make decisions and really support state planning. A second, when it comes to land, our key priority, not the only one, but really a key one, that overarches everything is expediting our cleanup of contaminated properties and lands so that they can be returned to productive reuse. And we have a real strong focus, because it is a direct implementation program, but also because it's a national priority, on the Superfund program, which is our most contaminated sites nationally. We just last week announced the completion of the Superfund Task Force report, which is where over the last year and a half we've really focused on what can we better do to get these decisions made at these sites and to get site cleanups happening faster. When he announced the rollout of the final report, the administrator made the point that we call the list of Superfund sites our national priorities list, but in point of fact, sites can sit on that list for decades with nothing happening, and that is really not how you would address a national priority. And so we are really keenly focused on trying to move these cleanups forward. The other thing I will note in land, because it's a big issue here in Region 4, is CCR, coal combustion residuals. We in Region 4 have a lot of coal ash ponds. We've got 187 impoundments across the region. And so we are focused on the national rulemaking and on the national process. Certainly since the 2015 CCR rule came out, there have been a lot of developments both legislatively and judicially, and so we still don't perfectly have the regulatory framework in place to fully address all the judicial input we've gotten. But that's a key priority nationally, is the rulemakings to take the direction we've gotten and establish the CCR permitting program, the program. But in the region, our focus really is supporting states that may be interested in taking on the program. So right now, a state couldn't assume the whole program because we don't have the whole framework laid out yet, but we absolutely can do partial approvals, and we support states that are interested in doing that. And so right now we're working with the states of Georgia and Alabama, and any of our states who have that interest. On the water side, and I won't talk too long because Pete's here, and Pete will have a lot to add on the water side, but certainly WOTUS and water infrastructure are key priorities, and we'll talk about those later. I would also call out nutrients and addressing nutrient pollution in our waterways as a key focus for us. We've talked about nutrients for a long time in water, but we haven't really made a lot of progress, and we're really seeing impacts to our water bodies. We've seen significant impacts to the city of Toledo's water supply that really created a public emergency. Every year we really see HABs along the coast of Florida that really create very significant issues for the economy and the quality of life for folks down there. We every year measure the hypoxic zone in the Gulf of Mexico and compare it to the size of a northeastern state. You know, one year it's Connecticut, the next year it's New Jersey. That's kind of a crazy way to talk about a dead zone in a body of water. So we really are focused on finding tools to make a difference when it comes to addressing nutrients. And it's a hard issue because we don't really have a regulatory framework. But in truth, since most of this is really about land, often a large contributor is a land use practice, it's really a great opportunity to sort of foster partnerships. And so this administration really, I think, believes strongly in let's see if we can seed innovation and partnerships and see what the market can bring to bear. And so this is a great area of focus and opportunity for us in terms of improving water quality. And finally on water, I just hit that safe drinking water is a key focus for us. Safe drinking water for granted because it is just part of what we have in this country, which is an incredible blessing. It is really the product of an amazing amount of investment over decades. But it's an area that we have taken for granted, and it's an area where when we have issues, there's a direct and immediate public health impact. And so this administration wants to make sure that we do everything we can to ensure safe drinking water. So we're instituting drinking water as a national compliance initiative on the enforcement side. And so we'll be more engaged than we have been historically. And secondly, we're really focused on lead in water because that is really an issue where we have lead issues, particularly for our children. So we will be, in the very near future, issuing a proposed lead and copper rule. It's going to be a hard rule because dealing with lead in drinking water, there's just not an easy fix. But it's nonetheless an area where we need to advance our tools and advance our thinking and get back to work. So finally, before I turn this back to Sean, I'd say PFAS when it comes to like a multimedia issue, we're really focused on PFAS and finding tools to address this emerging contaminant in our waters and in our soils so that we can better understand exposures and toxicity and where we need to take action and then take action as needed. So I will say that's probably what I will start off with and turn it to Sean.
Excellent. Thank you. We really appreciate all the hard work. You know, as Deputy Commissioner, I find that my job is to reduce Tony's stress level, and you do it much better than I do, especially on some of those hard conversations. So thank you for all the hard work. But next I'm going to introduce our Kentucky Department folks. And I get the privilege to introduce my boss, Commissioner Hatton. Tony Hatton, since June of 18, he has served as our commissioner. prior to leading the department, Tony served as our director and assistant director of the Division of Waste Management since 2002. And I think with the patience of Job and the strength of Samson, Tony was able to revamp the Brownfields Redevelopment Program, and he also modernized the underground storage tank program. And both of those have had significant economic benefit for our Commonwealth. hundreds of millions of dollars. And as you drive by the soccer complex in Louisville, I hope you think of Commissioner Hatton. So let's go ahead and all thank Tony for his efforts in leading the department. I don't know what to say about Pete, except afterwards, I hope somebody asks him the tough question. What the hell is going on here, Pete? But in all seriousness, Pete is a national leader in carrying out the obligations and the duties of the Clean Water Act. And Pete's instrumental in ensuring all of us have clean water and that it's available to all of our Commonwealth and all of our residents. I think, you know, it'll be highlighted several times today, but over 95% of our residents have access to potable water in Kentucky, and that is truly remarkable. I don't know how many of you all farm, but digging through the dirt in Kentucky is a steep task. Pete's been instrumental in ensuring that we have all those water resources available to us, and wastewater is properly managed. And if you really want to see Pete light up, you ask him about surveying Glens Creek or Elkhorn with his son Will, and you'll really see him shine. So, Pete, thank you for all your hard work.
Thank you.
And last not but least, I get to introduce my good friend, Melissa Duff. Melissa serves as the director of the Division for Air Quality. She joined the division in 2002, and prior to that, she was a process and quality control engineer, and she brought all of those talents to the division, and she's improved us dramatically. The efficiency improvements that Melissa has implemented has reduced the cost and the burden, and it's allowed us to work more efficiently with less. So, those of you all that might not know Melissa, she's an avid motorcycle enthusiast, and her dog's name Harley. So, she's quite the character. But Melissa's hard work, her work ethic really inspired all of us to work harder in the division, and I think we've been able to be successful in improving air quality and managing those air resources to allow for economic growth and development. So let's thank Melissa as well. So, Commissioner Hatton, would you?
Yeah, I'll follow on with some opening remarks too. Welcome to everyone that's here, my colleagues from DEP. I just want to reiterate, I think most of you know this, that know me, that I really see it as a privilege to be able to work with you all, and I consider you to be my colleagues, and we have an important job that we do. And while there may be differing opinions, I think by and large we do a really good job. And so I want to personally thank each and every one of you that are here for your public service, and just to tell you once again that I enjoy being your colleagues in the department. And for those of you who are not part of the agency, welcome. I see a few faces that I know. And one of the things that became pretty obvious to me during the first panel is that they hijacked our agenda. But then again, they're able to do that, but we'll make it work anyway. So if you look at the agenda, you'll see we want to talk about ACE, WOTUS, and water infrastructure. So some of the water infrastructure stuff you hear, we may be treading on ground we've already talked about, but it just sort of does go to emphasize the importance of that issue. And we'll probably drill a little bit deeper on the ACE and WOTUS piece of it, particularly when we begin to discuss how we as an agency are going to be responsible for implementing those rules as they get passed and updated. But I do want to mention a few other things that are just sort of broad across the department, things we've been working on and things that will be things we've been successful at and things we'll be concentrating on in 2020 in addition to all the other activities that we're responsible for, which are many. You know, on the air side, I do want to recognize the Division for Air Quality, because we've had significant amounts of economic development in the state here in the last 2 or 3 years, and we're always looking forward to that. But oftentimes, if someone's wanting to come into the state and establish some type of industrial facility, more often than not, they may have some type of air emission. And so, you know, the way the rules are written, you can't construct an air emissions unit until you have a permit from the agency. And so 9 times out of 10, when a project comes to Kentucky or gets identified, while waste and water also have some role in these economic development projects, an important role, it's almost always a Division for Air Quality that is called upon to be ready to review a permit, work with the permittee, and to the extent that we can engage in a timely permitting process. And the Division of Fair Quality has been able to do that to their credit, while at the same time ensuring that we're actually issuing good protective air permits. So I want to, for those of you that are here, and Melissa, I want to tell you how much I appreciate that. That's an important, that's a very practical example of where economic development and environmental protection, they can never be mutually exclusive. If you're on one pole or the other, you're not really in the conversation. So I'm very proud of our folks that we've been able to support those economic development projects in all of our programs. Bruce mentioned state-owned dams, about the necessity to have some type of emergency action plan, and that's I think we see that as an essential thing. But he also mentioned the cost. So we have dams for which the state is responsible, our state-owned dam repair program. And just to speak to the cost, depending on the size of a dam and the significance of the issues, it is extremely costly, to the point that probably the best we can do, at least here early on, is a project or two every 3 or 4 years. We do a 6-year budget, right? That right, Pete?
Yes.
We do a 6-year budget. We have worked on improving our ability to get contracts, but at the end of the day, these are very expensive projects. We work on one now, one of our higher risk dams, Bullock Pen, up in Grant County, and I think it's at a cost of about $15 million. So we're going to continue to work on that. But what that does say is, in the meantime, because it's a serious cost issue to fix them, in the meantime, it's pretty important to have an emergency action plan in the hopefully unlikely event that something were to happen until repairs are able to be made. We'll talk a little bit more about water infrastructure a little bit later on. I want to touch on a few other things because I'm sort of an old waste guy. I can't help it. I've been doing this for 32 years, so I want to give the waste side of it a little bit of play. Bruce had mentioned the CASTO program, where the legislature was gracious enough to provide money to the agency to go out and address some of these legacy sites. And the case Bruce was talking about was tanks and infrastructure related to oil and gas production that might be very not located in an area or a way it's such that it's a burden on farmers or others to be able to work around those things. Also, within the DEP side of it, though, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that we have a very long list of what we would call legacy sites that are in our state Superfund program. You know, the way the law reads is if someone causes a release to the environment that's not permitted, they have the responsibility of cleaning it up. The problem with that is that we find that a lot of these older sites, we don't know a whole lot about them, and when we do find out something about them, almost invariably, with very few exceptions, there's always a responsible party, but there's not often a viable responsible party. That's just the way that it is, because sites tend to outlive companies or people who are responsible for them. And that's okay. What that does mean, though, is that, you know, across the state, and I'm not shouting fire in a crowded theater here because that's not really what we have, but we do have this large list of sites for which we have very little resources to deal with them. And, you know, it's just one of those things that works out. Some of our programs where there are issues but perhaps less risk is where we have the money, and a program where we perhaps have more risk is where we struggle to get the funding to take care of the problems that we have. So we have a lot of these legacy sites, and we're in a holding pattern like we always are. You know, we have limited funding, and we're always going to respond to environmental emergencies as they arise. That's always job one. But many of these sites, they can become attractive nuisances depending on where they're at. We may have sites that are issues we don't know about. And I'll go ahead and mention, you know, one from a few years back up in Montgomery County, where we had a situation where we had for those of you who know the lingo, we have a fairly large group of former activities that were hazardous waste generators, but they never got a permit. They didn't have to get a permit. The generator registration is a lifetime registration, and many of them aren't even continuing to do the activity that they were doing at that time. We have a situation where that was the case, and then 15, 20 years later, the land use around there changed. People moved on to that property where that activity formerly took place, and all of a sudden we got a serious issue that the agency had to address. It cost us $6 million. And it wasn't about the money. It was the necessity to be able to respond, and I really appreciate Secretary Snavely supporting DEP and all the way up to the governor's office for making sure that we had the funding we needed to be able to do that. That's not a sustainable thing, because we have potentially other sites out there like that we have to triage and try to determine if we have a problem, but we have limited ability to react. And so that's something that I'm going to continue to try to work on, is we can identify ways in which perhaps we can do some of the work ourselves. We do have our friends from the state lab who assist us in that a lot. But that's a legacy Superfund sites where you have no viable RP are not only a potential risk to the public, but they really do impede economic development and redevelopment. So these brownfield sites, if there's some level of cleanup, I promise you, let the record show that a site that gets redeveloped that was formerly used, that the money it's invested in is many times over realized through the redevelopment process of that. And I'll speak real quickly because Sean was very gracious in the brownfields thing. It was something I was involved in. We were able to make it more attainable for a person who didn't cause a release to come in and purchase a property without unnecessarily taking on liability while at the same time not using the property in an improper manner. We've had a lot of success with that. I think we've had 260 sites, about 6,000 acres, where people have come in and assumed ownership of a property, and that returns jobs, tax roll, and also it sort of takes care of that problem of having sites where there's nobody to mine the store, and you worry about things like attractive nuisances and those kind of things. Mary also mentioned CCR, coal combustion residuals. I think in Kentucky we have probably close to 50 surface impoundments in the neighborhood of 14 or 15 landfills. Of course, when it came to CCR, the 2015 federal rule was a game changer. Kentucky has adopted the standards that are in the CCR rule. Presently, we do not have a permitting program. We are continuing to work with stakeholders in hopes that we can get a permitting program. And I'll say this, although I don't know if it's true, I think for the most part, I think the usefulness of a permitting program, which is certainly going to be useful, is going to be to deciding how to continue to permit existing facilities. There may be, although I'm not sure how likely there is going to be, a necessity for a new permit for a CCR disposal facility. There might be, and if there are, we need regulations for that. I will say this much, and I think this is an important thing to remember, we have to think about. And we've talked about this a little bit, Mary. You know, a lot of the requirements in the CCR rule have already come to pass. But one of the things going into the future is how do we address groundwater corrective action at CCR units? And I think there's, as we sit here right now, I think there's going to be a lot of uncertainty going forward as to whether or not a CCR unit can be managed in place when there are groundwater impacts, and to what degree are those impacts. And the reason I say that's an issue is because I think that's going to be something that's going to be litigated very heavily. And I think for those who are responsible for doing groundwater corrective action at a CCR facility, I think that's something that we're all going to have to face. The reality of it is, if at some point removals of ponds, we have estimated that those are going to be very expensive remediation projects, and ultimately they may fall to the ratepayer. So that's something that I think is sort of looming out there as the long pole in the tent. I know I need to move along here. I got two more things. We are currently working on our groundwater corrective action regulations. For those who've worked in waste and remediation and Superfund, you know that most regulatory programs, when it comes to groundwater corrective action, the basic rules are you shall clean it up without a lot of understanding as to exactly what constitutes that and what a cleanup is. I think if we are able to, and we intend to file regulations hopefully before too long, where we in Kentucky have added more certainty to what a groundwater remediation project ought to look like, because we've gone beyond simply just looking at a number or a standard and whether or not you meet that standard, but we've also sort of expanded it to looking not just at the source and the pathway, but what the real exposures are. And should other things other than just a number be taken into account? Should you consider the mass of a plume at a given point in time, the ability of that source, how old it is, to continue to support that plume, and all these things that should be taken into account, which in reality, groundwater remediation people have been doing for years and have had mixed results approaching regulatory agencies with these approaches. But we'll see how that works out. We've been working on that for quite a while. And then lastly, I do want to touch on the PFAS issue, perfluoroalkyl substances. Most of you probably have heard of them. Some of you haven't. They are an emerging contaminant. They are in a lot of products. They're, to some degree, they're ubiquitous in the environment. And when we were down in North Carolina, when we went to the lab over at the Research Triangle Park, that's where I first understood that these perfluoroalkyl substances are are voluminous in the numbers of them that there might be. There are a couple of them that are sort of the headline catchers now, and EPA has a health advisory of 70 parts per trillion in drinking water for PFAS. That's a really low amount. And some states have even moved ahead and are beginning to establish their own cleanup standards. But there are, seems like at this point, maybe 200 or 300 different compounds. So a lot of that is still developing. The science on it is still developing. The actual risk related to it, there's differences of opinion as to how you plug your numbers into the algorithm. That's a little bit unsettled right now. But I think it would be safe to say that depending on where this lands, if EPA determines to make it a hazardous substance under CERCLA, obviously we don't, that's not an issue right now for Kentucky because we have it covered under our pollutant and contaminant rule. But depending on how that weighs out at the end of the day, it could have significant impact on drinking water systems. It could have significant impact on potential sources of PFAS and significant impact on remediation costs. Because this much I do know about these materials, in a sense they don't play fair because they're very mobile, they're very persistent. They readily contaminate groundwater and are extremely difficult to remediate. So there's going to be a lot unfolding over the next coming years with regards to PFAS and the actual environmental impact and cost impact. And I do want to mention before I finish up that, you know, one of the, to me, I sort of try to break problems down and look at them in the simplest form. I think it's true in a permitting program. I think it's true in a cleanup program. You have a source, you have a pathway, you have an exposure. That's what you look at when you're issuing an air permit or a water permit. That's what you're looking at when you're trying to make decisions on a remediation project. With so much uncertainty with regards to what are the levels going to be, what are the true risks, we have developed a strategy. It's a draft strategy, but we've already begun to implement it. And the way in which we've approached it, because there's so much uncertainty, is we as an agency have chosen to look at the exposure piece of it first. Because as I understand it, the greatest risk from PFAS exposure is through drinking water, ingestion through drinking water. And so working with the Division of Water, and they've done an extremely good job, we are just about to finish up a fairly rigorous drinking water system sampling program. As a matter of fact, I think we might almost be done, and we're looking at pulling the information together. But we thought it was important to go ahead and take a look at what we're seeing in our finished drinking water. So I think we've sampled 80-some facilities across the state. One of the things that's made that feasible for us is that our own lab, our Department of Environmental Program Services, has been able to develop that method, and we're able to avoid a lot of costs that might otherwise be extremely costly. One of the things I think we'll find and we're hearing is that an analysis for PFAS is in the $400 or $500 range. There's limited labs that can do it. There's a lot of backlog, and the actual sampling protocol for when you go out and collect a sample of PFAS, if you've ever collected environmental samples, it's crazy. You gotta wear cotton clothes, you gotta wash them 6 times, you can't store your bottles in a vehicle that might have had Scotch Guard seats. It's an expensive undertaking, but I'm thankful that we have the ability within the department ourselves to do this analysis, and so I think that's the first and most important question that ought to be asked, and we're seeking an answer to that. And we may, matter of fact, before too long, enter into discussions amongst ourselves about what we may look at next, our ambient monitoring network. But we decided to start at the end of that equation, our exposures, and see what happens as information comes available if we have to work our way back up that equation to pathways and sources. So that's just a few things that we're continuing to work on the department that I want to share with you all.
Thank you, Commissioner. I noticed Renee Shaw finally got back to the room, and that was a hard act to follow, Secretary. In 4.5 years, when you retire from state government, I hope that KET calls. But we'll try to tease out some of the issues that were addressed in the earlier panel. I thought that was an excellent session. We're going to cover the waters of the U.S., some of the more recent regulatory developments. We'll discuss the Affordable Clean Energy Rule, and then we'll tease out some of the finer points to all of the challenges with water and wastewater infrastructure. So we'll change the format, and I'll have an opportunity to ask questions, and then we'll let Pete educate this. Pete's been trying to teach this old dog new tricks, and I know it's been tough, Pete, but I do catch a little bit here and there. And so Pete helped frame up some of these WOTUS questions for me to make sure that I didn't misspeak. But last week, EPA had a recent rule development, Administrator Walker, and it was the repeal of the 2015 rule outlined in previous administrations' interpretation regarding the jurisdictions, the jurisdiction waters of the Clean Water Act. We call it WOTUS, right? Right, Pete? Thank you.
I think EPA might not be doing that anymore.
Can you explain what the administration's interpretation of WOTUS is?
Yes, absolutely. And Matt actually did a fantastic job, but I want to reiterate a couple of things. And the first is that addressing WOTUS and having a proper definition of WOTUS is a key priority for us as an agency. It is a key priority for the president. Matt indicated it was perhaps the first executive order. One of the first directives we got from the president very early on in the administration was to look at the Clean Water Rule and consider rescinding and revising it. When we talk about the waters of the U.S. definition, it is really kind of foundational from a water regulatory standpoint. It is about where the Clean Water Act applies and really where is the boundary of federal and state authority. So it is a fundamental question in terms of how we operate and really legally the basis for what we do. And as has been noted, when the 2015 rule came out, it was widely viewed as regulatory overreach. 84 parties challenged, 31 states. It's a lot of states to challenge anything. That's more than just a party split. And we immediately entered into a world of a patchwork of stays. And so we have, for the last couple of years, been operating in this very uncertain environment and flux where what is the law of the land varies depending on what part of the country you're in, which is not good government, not reasonable regulation. So we were very pleased last week to announce the repeal of the 2015 rule, that repeal is final, and that the older regulations, the regulations we've been operating under since 1986, that you all in Kentucky continued to operate under with the court stay, that those are final, that those are in place for now. So we have, as Matt noted, applied kind of a stepwise approach for some of these regulatory reform efforts because we did need to make time and space to develop the final end result reg. So here, step one is, our first step is final. We have rescinded the Clean Water Rule. We have been working actively on our step two rule, which is actually the new definition of waters of the U.S. As we've done this, we've had really broad engagement. We reached out and worked closely with states and with tribes. We had a series of engagement from stakeholders across all the spectrum of parties, ag, water utilities, local governments, any industry interested in water, stakeholder groups. We have engaged to try to tease out, as we try to find this definite, as we work to define waters of the U.S., what is the proper balance? What is the proper path? It is a really hard question to answer. How do you sort of draw a line in water? And when you're talking about a rule that covers the expanse of land uses and land masses in our country and all the different types of water, it's a hard rule to write, but we are committed to having a clear definition that both protects our federal waters and respects the proper balance of state and federal authority, and ideally does it in a way that landowners can understand in looking at their own property if a permit is needed to take action. So we put out a proposal earlier this summer and have taken comment on a proposed definition for waters. And so it includes six very clearly defined bodies of types of water, traditionally navigable waters, tributaries, which would be where there's perennial flow or intermittent flow, but as Matt said, not just where it only flows when it rains, impoundments of jurisdictional waters, ditches, and those ditches are defined. So we're talking about ditches where a stream is channelized, not where a farmer has put, you know, a ditch in upland to drain, you know, to move water away from his field. Some lakes and ponds, and those are clearly defined. And adjacent wetlands to waters of the U.S. the rule that is proposed and that we're currently reviewing comments for retains all the prior exclusions, so prior converted cropland, stormwater, wastewater, ditches, groundwater is exempt as WOTUS, and very notably, and this is different from the prior rule, if a water in this proposal is not defined as a water of the U.S., then it is not a water of the U.S., in an attempt to try to provide some level of certainty and finality to this definition. So that getting this rule final is a key priority for us, and we aim to do it by probably early next year to have this out. Administrator Wheeler has said, I think every time I have heard him talk about this, that he personally believes that a person should be able to walk on their land and know if a federal permit is required, and that is really what we are aiming to do, to be fair, to be protective, to respect states' rights, and to give us a clear law of the land that we all can understand.
Excellent. Thank you. And once EPA establishes a rule, it's really the state's responsibility to implement and enforce. And one of the things Pete's been trying to educate me on, and it's tough, I know, but is the difference between waters of the U.S. and waters of the Commonwealth. And so once EPA finalizes the rule, Pete, what are you and the Division of Water going to have to do in response? And those gaps that, or that missing piece that Administrator Walker just mentioned.
Well, Mary did a great job of talking about how EPA sees that. That's really clear. And that last thing you mentioned about the default, if it's not defined, it's not part of it. And so that, so what's not covered under the jurisdictional waters of the U.S. is still waters of the Commonwealth. And we have water quality standards that apply, and that we have to protect those designated uses of those waters. So there may be gaps there, most notably isolated wetlands that aren't adjacent to waters of the U.S. and maybe some upland areas. I just flew to a whole bunch of different cities, but Texas, Oklahoma, San Diego, and when you fly over those states west of the 100th Meridian, you get a real appreciation for the impact of this rule. The impact of this rule on Kentucky is not going to be the same as it's going to be in New Mexico, I can tell you that, because you fly over New Mexico and almost all the waterways you see are ephemeral waterways. So they're really not jurisdictional. And that's a big lift from New Mexico. What are we going to do then? Because they still have their own water quality standards. So in those situations where you're not in a water of the U.S., but you have a discharge, either of effluent, traditional effluent that you would permit through the NPDES or KPDES program, or you have a dredge and fill type discharge that would be covered under the 404 program by the Corps of Engineers, but you're no longer in a jurisdictional water of the U.S., what do you have to do in Kentucky? And that's where the gap is. We've done an analysis of this, and for the most part, we believe if you have an effluent discharge, that you're probably going to have some nexus to the waters of the U.S., and that rule that we anticipate basically will say you still have to have the federal permit because you're still impacting that. There's some arguments about what the point of compliance, et cetera, may be, but we have still the water quality standards of the state apply, and we have to protect those water quality standards and those designated uses. On the dredge and fill operation, if you're doing a dredge and fill, and these are pretty common stream crossings, a lot of bridge construction, marina construction, those aren't most of those big projects are going to be on waters of the U.S., but there'll be smaller projects where they're dredge and fill things. And so there's clearly going to be a disruption or a non-conformity with the state water quality standards. So we have to develop some sort of authorization process to address that. And I see that probably as tiered, you know, where we have nationwide permits, some general permit and guidance in terms of what you do versus more complex projects would be probably an individual permit, but there are a lot of things to tease out. But I think Mary hit on one key point that Administrator Wheeler said. Somebody should be able to walk on their land and know whether they're in a jurisdictional water and whether they need a federal permit or a state permit. That's going to be on us, I think, to provide clear answers to landowners, because the last thing they want to do is call the Corps of Engineers up and say, will you come out to my property and do a jurisdictional determination to tell me if I'm in waters of the U.S.? And then tell me if I need a permit, you know. So we have to improve our communication there, and we have to have a clear path forward for the regulated public if they're going to, if they're going to need a permit, what does that look like? And do they have to have a federal permit? Do they have to have a state permit? And what is that process? It's got to be transparent, fairly predictable, right. I think, and something that understandable.
And to provide that regulatory certainty and how it's going to impact the regulated entities, I mean, you foresee rulemaking, or do you just see it handling through process of issuing permits? Or?
Well, I think on some of it, we may need to do some rulemaking, some regulation adjustment. As always, we don't develop regulatory programs independent of stakeholders. We
right.
very much use stakeholders in our process. And like you said, the predictability of the, you know, the transparency and predictability is going to be key. And there's legal analysis that needs to be done, too. And so I'm guessing at what the rule's going to say. You know, pretty good idea, but the devil's in the details. And so we can't really do anything until we see that rule and then start making some determinations of how we want to move forward as a state.
Excellent. Thank you. And I guess, you know, and this is another area that Pete's trying to educate me on, but wetland protections. And only two states have assumed delegation of authority for the 404 program. Can you discuss why more states haven't taken advantage or taken that leap of faith?
Sure. we've talked about this a lot. I think Pete and I have probably talked about this a lot in, as part of that national outreach. The Clean Water Act really was designed for delegation. Almost every state in the country has taken the NPDES side of the Clean Water Act programs, but only two have taken the 404, the 404 permitting program. I think Bruce and I have been at ECOS meetings where this has been discussed, and there probably are a number of reasons. I think one of the critical ones really is basic and its funding. So we do have federal dollars that we provide to state water programs, but those are allocated, and so there is no additional funding when a state assumes the 404 program to allow for administering that program. So a state really has to be able to bring those resources to the table. So that has been a key impediment in many regards. A second thing that has been an impediment for those states that were interested and willing has been historically the Corps' view of what waters a state could assume. There is a narrow set of waters that the Corps must always retain permitting authority for national reasons. So historically, you go to the Corps if you're interested in assuming the program, and the Corps helps you understand how much of the waters in your state you could assume permitting responsibility for. And in past administrations, when that's been done, the Corps' answer has been really, really limited to such a degree that it wasn't really worth the squeeze for a state to take it on. We convened an advisory committee with states and the Corps to talk about this and to try to come to a resolution as to what is the proper balance of waters that a state can assume. And there just was, up until this administration, there was disagreement between states and EPA and the Corps, with the Corps' belief that they needed to retain just about all the waters. The Corps has revised their opinion on that, and today agrees with the majority position that there's a pretty broad swath of waters in many states that can be assumed, that where the Corps needs to retain it is a fairly narrow band of Section 10 waters. So that's a key, has been a key issue that it seems to be resolving. A third issue that comes up is how do we manage Endangered Species Act requirements in a delegated program? That's an area we're still kind of thinking through. And then finally, and Pete, you may have others that you might note, partial assumption is something that the current regs don't provide. And so it is something that perhaps there would be some states that would be interested in taking part of the program, but not the entire breadth of the program. We have been thinking about what we can do to facilitate state assumption. And so we do plan to have a rulemaking where we'll consider some of these key things. We don't really have the ability on the funding side to address that because that's a Congress thing. But many of the structural issues associated with assumption, we'd like to try to clarify and address in a rulemaking. So that should be coming up.
Thank you. And Pete, we're not a delegated authority for 404. What are some of the challenges that you face in trying to assume delegation?
Well, Mary laid out a lot of good things. So this was studied by the cabinet during the Fletcher administration under Secretary Wilcher. And I don't know exactly how it concluded, that it was no big statement, but I think it became such a lift that I think people kind of lost that didn't seem like it was going to be possible. So first thing you got to look at is what's the cost to do it for the state? And Mary said, you know, is the juice worth the squeeze? That's a really big, important way to look at it. And the cost of that program would be pretty substantial for the state. And then, so if you assume you're not going to get new general funding to subsidize that program, what are the fee structures going to be, and how many permits do you issue, and what's that fee going to cost that permittee? And that can be fairly daunting, because those costs are north of $10 million a year to do that program. And there's not that many individual permits that are issued in the state. The other thing, that percentage of Section 10 waters under the 1899 River and Harbors Act that Mary talked about, that narrow set, that's a pretty big bite in Kentucky, because we have such big waters of the major rivers, the Mississippi, the Ohio, and then the major tribs to that. So there's a lot of Section 10 waters in Kentucky. And the Corps' position at the highest level has evolved to maybe seeding that program. At the district level, I would say maybe not. And so each of the districts in the Corps of Engineers has its own personality, and I don't know if they're there yet or not, but that said, the other thing is the expectation of regulated entities in terms of what the timing is, the cost of those permits, the complexity of the permits, and mitigation. How do you deal with mitigation and mitigation costs? That's the real driver on a lot of this, is that why do I have to spend that kind of money to mitigate waters that I control my own property? Why am I spending that enormous amount of money? And mitigation has become very expensive. For us, as a practical matter, recruiting and retaining, training and retaining qualified staff, technical personnel to do a program, that's no small lift either. That's a very big lift. Other states such as Indiana and Arizona are going to pursue this under 404G. They're going to pursue primacy. I think it's a good opportunity for us to sort of watch how that goes and learn from their experience. And then we'll see. I'm not sure how much desire at the local level in Kentucky there is for the cabinet to seek primacy under 404. I guess we'll find out maybe early next year when that rule comes out. We'll get some sense of that. In any case, the cabinet's been working a lot, and I appreciate leadership of Secretary Snavely and Bruce Scott, and working with them to make sure that the 401 and the 404 program and the water quality certification under Clean Water Act Section 401, as well as mitigation and the in-lieu fee program, that those programs are transparent, efficient, and predictable. We've worked a bunch with the Corps in the last year and a half or so. For instance, we worked on mitigation service areas, and they finalized those areas, and wasn't completely aligned with what the cabinet was hoping for, but that was a big move in the direction we needed them to move. We've been working on some other issues with the Corps on resolving some outstanding issues on severed mineral rights, and then we also have been talking to them about establishing a couple other in-lieu fee funds, so that you're not just doing stream when you do mitigation, that you're not just doing in-stream mitigation or in-water body mitigation, that can set aside some of that for water or wastewater infrastructure projects that would have a positive impact on water quality and habitat. And also a possibility of working on setting aside some of that to protect threatened and endangered species. So we have been working a lot more with the Corps. We'll see, as the rule comes out, if there's a lot of expectation for us to do something relative to primacy. But in any case, we're going to be working with the Corps indefinitely, and so we have to make sure that those programs are working smartly and working well together.
Thank you, Pete. Well, moving on to a subject I'm more familiar with would be the Affordable Clean Energy Rule. And it was discussed by Matt this morning. I think he covered it well and explained the significant differences between the Affordable Clean Energy Rule and the Clean Power Plan. But what is the scope of the Affordable Clean Energy Administrator Walker, and what does it do, and what's the current status?
So I will be. Matt really did a fantastic job covering it. We are really pleased that the current status is it's final and effective. So y'all know, as Matt said, ACE is our administration's response to the Clean Power Plan. It is a rule that operates within the fence line. So like Clean Power Plan, it's an emissions guideline, establishes emissions guidelines under Section 111D of the Clean Air Act. But unlike the Clean Power Plan, it really very much targets the actual regulated unit as opposed to really more broadly looking across the industry sector and trying to shift generation away from coal. So the rule had three basic parts. The first was to repeal the Clean Power Plan. The second was to establish the ACE emission guidelines, how this emission guideline would operate, which is effectively establishing the best system of emission reduction, which was heat rate improvements. And then states go forth and apply that and develop plans for emissions reductions at these units. And then the third piece of the rule was broader, not just for carbon dioxide emissions at existing plants, but for all regulations under 111D. Given the way that the Clean Power Plan was promulgated, really it mattered, I think, articulated a number of issues with that rulemaking. The third part was to address 111D emissions guidelines broadly from a process standpoint and put in place changes to the implementing regs for 111D. So address some process and timing issues for how those emissions guidelines can be issued. And made it clear that states have discretion as they apply the BSER. And so those were some key changes that we think are really material and allow us to address carbon emissions from existing power plants. As Matt said, we'll continue to drive reductions, 35% by the time it's fully implemented over the 2005 baseline, but do it in a way that really is sort of faithful to the authority under the Clean Air Act.
Great, thank you. And then Director Duff. How is this going to affect Kentucky, and what is our response in fulfilling those obligations?
Well, with the rule being final, we are responsible for developing and submitting an approvable state plan to EPA. Kentucky, it only applies to the existing fossil fuel utilities, which we have 43, and I think about 38 or 39 are actually still operating. The states responsible for developing the plan will have to collect the information from our utilities, review it, determine what the emission standard would be, and then we'll be responsible for implementing it once the plan's approved by EPA. It's a big lift. It's a significant lift because each unit will have to be evaluated on its own, but it's something that we think fits within the guidelines and the statutory obligations.
Great, thank you. And then we've talked about the Clean Power Plan. What are the fundamental differences between the Clean Power Plan and ACE?
Okay, so certainly the big one is within the fence line or outside the fence line. Clean Power Plan really focused on generation shifting. ACE really focuses on emissions reductions at the unit. In terms of how it was done, there are a couple of key differences that I think we all perceived when it was issued. The first one really is the BSE, the best system of emissions reduction, and what that was in Clean Power Plan and what that is in ACE. And so in Clean Power Plan, because it really was fundamentally about generation shifting, the BSER was first, it was three steps. It was first, heat rate improvements at the immediate unit. It was second, increasing natural gas dispatch to shift generation away from coal units. And then it was third, increasing use of renewables to further shift generation from coal-fired units. With ACE, the best system of emissions reduction is at the unit. It is the heat rate improvements at the unit as air regulation is designed to be. So fundamentally, what that does is reflect a fundamentally different approach in a respect for states' authorities as they kind of plan their energy mix and electricity, how they plan their electricity generating sector. A second key thing, the second thing is kind of a process thing. I think probably one of the key reasons we looked at the guidelines was when Clean Power Plan came out, states were given a state-specific, you know, EPA applied the BSER, and states were given their target. And each of us was given a different number, and we were told, go forth and achieve that number, as opposed to a state looking at the BSER and applying it to its units. And so there's a fundamental difference in how the BSER is applied, and states have more authority under ACE than certainly than under the Clean Power Plan. And third, just from a timing standpoint, under the Clean Power Plan, states were given a year to just kind of get it done, which is was an incredibly tall order. Administrator Duff is right. 3 years is still a pretty tight timeline. With ACE, states have 3 years, which is a more appropriate timeline, but still, it's a large task. And so fundamentally, I think, with inside the fence line or outside the fence line, and more timing and more control for states under ACE.
And that mass goal for Kentucky was 63 million tons, and we were already at that level in 2018 or 2019. I think, and it was stayed, and it was never in effect. But well, throughout the promulgation, Melissa, the cabinet and the division provided significant technical comments as well as challenged the rule. Does ACE fit inside those comments and kind of the structure that we thought was appropriate?
It absolutely does. It aligns with what our issues were with the Clean Power Plan and what we commented on and said that it should be, which is, you know, stay within the framework of 111D, which it does, by not considering things that, you know, it addresses the emissions at the source and not elsewhere. And it also reestablishes the role, our role as states in developing and implementing the plan that works for us. By allowing states to determine which best system of emission reductions is applicable to each individual unit, because as Matt said earlier this morning, I thought that was a great analogy. They're each a snowflake. None of them are the same, which I think a lot of people probably don't realize. Each individual unit is absolutely individual, and what works for one unit is not necessarily going to work for all units. So having a number imposed on us versus looking at what works for each unit to get the right technology applied to reduce the emissions makes more sense. It has to be, and for us, it's got to be, you know, the reduction has to be quantifiable, permanent, enforceable, which is what we've said in our comments. And the change to 3 years, thank you. I can't imagine what we really struggled with. What would we do in a year? What could we really do? And even though 3 years is probably a tight timeline, it's much more achievable and makes much more sense. Not just for this, but, you know, in moving forward with other 111D plans that may come down the pike.
Excellent. Well, now that ACE is final, what is Kentucky doing in response?
So we've already had a couple of stakeholder meetings with our utilities discussing how we're going to approach it. We've laid out a plan. Pretty soon we'll be sending out a letter requesting the information from them. It'll have to come in. They'll have to do some evaluation, provide us with a lot of information. We'll have to review it, determine whether or not it's appropriate. One of the pluses in the ACE rule is now you get to look at remaining useful life. Which could be, at least we know for several units, is a big issue, and it will come into play. But once we've done that, we'll develop the plan, we submit it to EPA for approval, and then once approved, it's up to us. We'll have to go back and put in each standard for each unit into their Title V operating permits in order to make it enforceable.
Well, thank you. I think one of the topics this morning that concerns all of us as residents of the Commonwealth is infrastructure issues. And so we're going to transition over to water and wastewater infrastructure issues. And from a national or regional perspective, can you just elaborate on some of the challenges that we face?
Sure. Your leadership really captured the challenges with our aging infrastructure incredibly well. Certainly, it is, I think, to my mind, one of the most heartening things about this discussion is that we are talking about it nationally at every place. There's an awareness that we have to do something about our infrastructure. Here in the Southeast, we have the blessing and the curse of population growth. We have seen incredible population growth in our eight Southeastern states. So in 1950, the population of these eight states was 23 million, and today it is 64 million. So really rapid growth, but that growth has not been uneven, and we've seen population shifts within the region. And so we have areas that are booming and have incredible infrastructure needs, particularly stormwater on our coast and in certain urban areas. But we also have large swaths of the region where we have declining populations and declining rate bases. And so as we're dealing with the aging infrastructure, we don't have the rate base to support the improvements that are needed, much less improvements to deal with new and emerging challenges. So funding for infrastructure is key. I guess y'all's number is $14 billion over 20 years. Nationally, the estimate is that we will need $700 billion over the next 20 years to modernize our water and wastewater infrastructure, which is a staggering amount. So we have added the WIFIA fund, which is another fund source that we can add to the SRFs to apply additional funding. And funding is key. I loved that. I wrote down the analogy that we really need to think about this as an investment in our communities. I think that's fantastic because it's true. A second piece that y'all touched on as well is it's not just funding. It's also leadership and capacity. And so we have small system issues where we have real challenges with compliance because the utility, and in y'all's cases it's really a utility, but in some parts of the country, of the region it's a utility, just doesn't have the capacity to comply. There is not expertise. We don't have qualified operators. We don't have a utility that could pay to get a qualified operator. And so we really struggle with how do we put in place the support and the requirements to address those. You all, by virtue of your strong focus on regionalization, really lead here because I know it is perhaps not always easy and maybe not always perfect, but it does address, give you a tool to address some of the real challenges we see with these very small systems that really don't have the capacity. And even were we to fully grant fund their infrastructure completely, I don't know that they could operate and sustain it. So small systems are a real issue. The other thing I'll just kind of touch on is water supply is an issue of focus nationally and even really here in parts of the Southeast. So in a GAO survey, 40 of 50 state water managers say that they expect to face freshwater shortages in at least parts of their state in the next 10 years. And so this is just an area that we're beginning to talk about at the federal level. How can we seed innovate? How can we think long-term and strategically about our water supply needs? So, yeah.
Thank you. And Commissioner, from Kentucky's perspective, what are some of the challenges that we face?
I don't really have anything to add to what Mary said. I think she covered pretty well. I think for existing systems, it's do the rates allow for reinvestment? Regionalization, as we heard earlier this morning, can be a good thing, and it's oftentimes also a result of challenges. There's funding challenges there. There's political challenges. There's geography and topography challenges there. But we, at least in Kentucky, we've seen the overall benefit of it. We have 97% of our citizens are on municipally treated drinking water. And then I think the funding issue, obviously, as we've talked about, as talked about earlier this morning, there's dollars available. Sometimes people are reticent or cautious about borrowing money. The question comes up, is there a way to, in addition to money that we borrowed, generate revenue for making grants to support regionalization? Those are the same challenges here and everywhere, so I think we can handle what Mary's already said.
Thank you. And Pete, you're on the task force. Representative Gooch mentioned the wastewater infrastructure task force, and I think in July you presented with Deputy Secretary Scott. Can you just explain some of the challenges that you're going to address in dealing with those issues?
Well, the task force is sort of borne out a couple of failed concurrent resolutions in the last session, but we were sort of surprised when LRC came out and said they're going to form this task force. And so we met three times. We're going to meet again in October. But we're focusing on some of the things that Mary and Tony talked about what's sort of the status of infrastructure, water, and wastewater. And I could drone on for a long time about statistics about it's largely age, failure to invest, capacity that Mary talked about from operators, technical, financial, managerial capacity. Those are issues that are challenges for a lot of systems, not just small systems either. Some remarkably bigger systems. I can pick on Toledo because it's not in Kentucky. But when they went to Toledo to deal with the HAB issues, they found a mess. And they not just with the source water, but the filter room and the condition of the electrical system and their lack of redundancy and storage. And so they took, Governor Kasich took action to require mandatory asset management for all water systems in the state. So this task force is looking at the same kind of things. And I think you heard Representative Gooch. He recognizes the need, the financial need, but he also sort of mentioned that maybe there's some accountability issues that we need to address with those systems, and that includes training as well as some other things. And I'm hopeful that we'll come to something. It's just sort of a compressed schedule, so to come out of that with some recommendations for the General Assembly, with something that really tangible recommendations, is going to be a very difficult challenge in the next couple of months. But we're going to work on it.
And you also spoke about House Bill 513 and the regionalization of wastewater treatment plants. Can you explain your perspective on some of how the benefits?
So, real quickly, House Bill 513 was a bill that we supported that basically gave us some tools to better oversee small, privately owned wastewater treatment plants and to deal with those more effectively because they have significant issues. And it all sort of was born out of several years ago. We had a small privately owned wastewater treatment plant in Bullitt County fail completely. And the fallout from that has been fairly profound for the people in northern Bullitt County and the local ratepayers. There's been bankruptcy issues and some bankruptcy decisions that may affect those ratepayers. There's nothing like a tragedy like that to bring people's eye to the issue. And so we had this bill to do that, and it had broad support. The unpredictability of the legislative process is that there was another bill that we supported on the regionalization issue that sort of got hijacked and became the controversial state employee retirement bill. We were able to kind of take the original language out of that Senate Bill 50 and append it to House Bill 513, and that all passed out through the General Assembly and was signed by the governor. And that basically, that aspect of the bill, allows water districts, sanitation districts, joint sewer authorities, et cetera, to, on voluntary agreement, own or operate facilities outside of their jurisdiction. That's going to be a really powerful tool for moving forward. There are a couple of good examples of what's happening there already. But in terms of, I think we're going to get to version 2.0 of consolidation and regionalization. We're going to see another thing. The economies of scale are changing so rapidly for those systems that I think we're going to see bigger, more regional utilities. And so this allows some of the opportunity for municipalities and joint sewer authorities, sanitation districts to play a more regional role. And they do have the capacity, some of them. I'll give you a couple examples. Crestwood had sent their sewage to MSD in Louisville for years, but they wanted out of the business. That allowed MSD to come in and purchase that whole system and operate it. Oldham County Environmental Authority, who just built a regional facility not 5 years ago, is already up against the affordability to run their whole system. And they are working with MSD, Louisville MSD, and the fiscal court, and Louisville MSD is going to take over all of Oldham County's wastewater facilities, which will allow almost immediately three package plants to come off, and will take some pressure off some other parts of the system in terms of sewer capacity, et cetera. We're anticipating some other actions in Franklin County over the next several years, and in Bullitt County, hopefully, and elsewhere across the state. So that has a great potential, and I know I've talked to Bruce about it. That was a big deal. That bill was a very big deal.
Well, like in the Oldham County situation, how does that affect the ratepayers?
Well, in Oldham County, part of the attraction to that is that they had so few ratepayers, and they did some things that they acquired a lot of debt building that regional facility, and it was very proximal to another regional facility of MSD. And we had a lot of talks before they did that. But they decided that they wanted to be their own thing. But then their rates are up in the $80 per month, and that's their average rate. And so MSD is going to insure them a much lower rate over a longer period of time until those rates catch up to each other through natural rate adjustments. So it's going to save in the first couple of years several million dollars of Oldham County citizens paying rates that are lower that they're paying now. So in some other cases, it's going, they're invariably going to, rates are going to have to go up for some people because their systems are failing. And what's subsidizing that is the streams are a mess, or there are overflows in yards and homes and other things. And because the rates that they're being charged don't square with the cost of service and the need for investment. So in some cases, it'll go up. In the case of Oldham County, it actually went down, which is remarkable.
Great. Thank you. And I think we're out of time, but closing remarks from Administrator Walker, Commissioner Hatton.
So thanks for the invitation to be here. It's lovely to meet with y'all and talk to everybody.
Thank you for your
time. I won't take any more time other than if we may have some questions. We'd be certainly glad to try to address those.
We could open it up for a couple questions if we have any. I can't see you out there, but any questions? All right. I believe everybody's ready for lunch. So with that, we'll transition over to the next room, and we'll have an award ceremony. So thank you all.